The Masoretic text is the authoritative Hebrew and Aramaic text of the Tanakh for Rabbinic Judaism. However, contemporary scholars seeking to understand the history of the Hebrew Bible's text use a range of other sources. These include Greek and Syriac translations, quotations from rabbinic manuscripts, the Samaritan Pentateuch and others such as the Dead Sea Scrolls. Many of these are older than the Masoretic text and often contradict it. While the Masoretic text defines the books of the Jewish canon, it also defines the precise letter text of these biblical books, with their vocalization and accentuation known as the Masorah. The Mount is widely used as the basis for translations of the Old Testament in Protestant Bibles, and in recent years also for some Catholic Bibles. Although the Eastern Orthodox churches continue to use the Septuagint, as they hold it to be divinely inspired, in modern times the Dead Sea Scrolls have shown the Mount to be nearly identical to some texts of the Tanakh dating from 200 BCE but different from others. The Mount was primarily copied, edited and distributed by a group of Jews known as the Masoretes between the 7th and 10th centuries CE. Though the consonants differ little from the text generally accepted in the early 2nd century, it has numerous differences of both greater and lesser significance when compared to manuscripts of the Septuagint, a Greek translation of the Hebrew scriptures that was in popular use in Egypt and Israel. The Hebrew word Masorah refers to the transmission of a tradition. In a very broad sense, it can refer to the entire chain of Jewish tradition. But in reference to the Masoretic text, the word Masorah has a very specific meaning. The diacritic markings of the text of the Hebrew Bible and concise marginal notes in manuscripts of the Hebrew Bible, which note textual details, usually about the precise spelling of words. The oldest extant manuscripts of the Masoretic text date from approximately the 9th century CE. The Aleppo Codex dates from the 10th century. Origin and transmission. The Talmud states that a standard copy of the Hebrew Bible was kept in the court of the temple in Jerusalem for the benefit of copyists. There were paid correctors of biblical books among the officers of the temple. This copy is mentioned in the letter of Aristeus, in the statements of Philo and in Josephus. A Talmudist story, perhaps referring to an earlier time, relates that three Torah scrolls were found in the temple court but were at variance with each other. The differences were then resolved by majority decision among the three. Second Temple period. The discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls at Qumran, dating from c. 150 BCE to 75 CE, shows that in this period there was not always the scrupulous uniformity of text that was so stressed in later centuries. According to Menahem Cohen, the Dead Sea Scrolls decided these issues by showing that there was indeed a Hebrew text type on which the Septuagint translation was based in, which differed substantially from the received Mount. The scrolls show numerous small variations in orthography, both as against the later Masoretic texts and between each other. It is also evident from the notings of corrections and variant alternatives that scribes felt free to choose according to their personal taste and discretion between different readings. However, despite these variations, most of the Qumran fragments can be classified as being closer to the Masoretic text than to any other text group that has survived. According to Lawrence Schiffman, 60% can be classed as being of proto-Masoretic type, and a further 20% Qumran style with bases in proto-Masoretic texts, compared to 5% proto-Samaritan type, 5% Septuagintal type, and 10% non-aligned. Joseph Fitzmyer noted the following regarding the findings at Qumran Cave 4 in particular. Such ancient recensional forms of Old Testament books bear witness to an unsuspected textual diversity that once existed. These texts merit far greater study and attention than they have been accorded till now. Thus, the differences in the Septuagint are no longer considered the result of a poor or tendentious attempt to translate the Hebrew into the Greek. Rather, they testify to a different pre-Christian form of the Hebrew text. On the other hand, some of the fragments conforming most accurately to the Masoretic text were found in Cave 4. Rabbinic period and emphasis on minute details of words and spellings, already used among the Pharisees as basis for argumentation, reached its height with the example of Rabbi Akiva. The idea of a perfect text sanctified in its consonantal base quickly spread throughout the Jewish communities via supportive statements in Halakha, Agada, and Jewish thought, and with it increasingly forceful strictures that a deviation in even a single letter would make a Torah scroll invalid. Very few manuscripts are said to have survived the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 CE. This both drastically reduced the number of variants in circulation, and gave a new urgency that the text must be preserved. New Greek translations were also made. Unlike the Septuagint, large-scale deviations in sense between the Greek of Aquila and Theodotion and what we now know as the Masoretic text are minimal. Detailed variations between different Hebrew texts in use still clearly existed though, as witnessed by differences between the present-day Masoretic text and versions mentioned in the Gemara, and often even Halachic Midrashim based on spelling versions which do not exist in the current Masoretic text. The age of the Masoretic, the current received text, finally achieved predominance through the reputation of the Masoretic. Schools of scribes and Torah scholars working between the 7th and 11th centuries, based primarily in the land of Israel in the cities of Tiberias and Jerusalem, and in Babylonia. According to Menachem Cohen, these schools developed such prestige for the accuracy and error control of their copying techniques that their texts established an authority beyond all others. Differences remained, sometimes bolstered by systematic local differences in pronunciation and cantillation. Every locality, following the tradition of its school, had a standard codex embodying its readings. In Babylonia, the school of Sarah differed from that of Nehardi, and similar differences existed in the schools of the land of Israel as against that at Tiberias, which in later times increasingly became the chief seat of learning. In this period, living tradition ceased, and the Masoretic in preparing their codices usually followed the one school or the other, examining, however, standard codices of other schools and noting their differences. Ben Asher and Ben Naphtali in the first half of the 10th century, Aaron ben Moses ben Asher and Moshe ben Naphtali were the leading Masoretic in Tiberias. Their names have come to symbolize the variations among Masoretic, but the differences between Ben Asher and Ben Naphtali should not be exaggerated. There are hardly any differences between them regarding the consonants, though they differ more on vocalization and accents. Also, there were other authorities such as Rabbi Pinches and Moshe Mohi, and Ben Asher and Ben Naphtali often agree against these others. Further, it is possible that all variations found among manuscripts eventually came to be regarded as disagreements between these figureheads. Ben Asher wrote a standard codex embodying his opinions. Probably Ben Naphtali did too, but it has not survived. It has been suggested that there never was an actual Ben Naphtali, rather, the name was chosen to designate any tradition different from Ben Asher's. Ben Asher was the last of a distinguished family of Masoretic extending back to the latter half of the 8th century. Despite the rivalry of Ben Naphtali and the opposition of Sadia Gaon, the most eminent representative of the Babylonian school of criticism, Ben Asher's codex became recognized as the standard text of the Bible. See Aleppo Codex, Codex Carensis. Most of the secular scholars conclude that Aaron ben Asher was a Karaite, though there is evidence against this view. The Middle Ages, the two rival authorities, Ben Asher and Ben Naphtali, practically brought the Masorah to a close. Very few additions were made by the later Masoretic, styled in the 13th and 14th centuries Nakadanim, who revised the works of the copyists, added the vowels and accents, and frequently the Masorah. Considerable influence on the development and spread of Masoretic literature was exercised during the 11th, 12th, and 13th centuries by the Franco-German school of Tosafists. R. Gershom, his brother Machir, Joseph Ben Samuel Bonfils of Limoges, Tam, Menahem Ben Perez of Joigny, Perez Ben Elijah of Corbeil, Judah of Paris, Mir Spira, and R. Mir of Rothenburg made Masoretic compilations, or additions to the subject, which are all more or less frequently referred to in the marginal glosses of biblical codices and in the works of Hebrew grammarians. Masora. By long tradition, a ritual Sefer Torah could contain only the Hebrew consonantal text, nothing added, nothing taken away. The Masoretic codices, however, provide extensive additional material, called Masora, to show correct pronunciation and cantillation, protect against scribal errors, and annotate possible variants. The manuscripts thus include vowel points, pronunciation marks and stress accents in the text, short annotations in the side margins, and longer more extensive notes in the upper and lower margins and collected at the end of each book. These notes were added because the Masoretes recognized the possibility of human error in copying the Hebrew Bible. The Masoretes were not working with the original Hebrew manuscripts of the Bible. Corruptions had already crept into the versions they copied. Etymology: the Hebrew word Masorah is taken from Ezekiel chapter 20 verse 37 and means originally feta. The fixation of the text was considered to be in the nature of a feta upon its exposition. When, in the course of time, the Masorah had become a traditional discipline, the term became connected with the verb, and acquired the general meaning of tradition, language and form. The language of the Masoretic notes is primarily Aramaic but partly Hebrew. The Masoretic annotations are found in various forms, in separate works, e.g., the Okla Weokla, in the form of notes written in the margins and at the end of codices. In rare cases, the notes are written between the lines. The first word of each biblical book is also as a rule surrounded by notes. The latter are called the initial masora. The notes on the side margins or between the columns are called the small or inner masora, and those on the lower and upper margins, the large or outer masora. The name large masora is applied sometimes to the lexically arranged notes at the end of the printed Bible, usually called the final masora, or the Masoretic Concordance. The small Masorah consists of brief notes with reference to marginal readings, to statistics showing the number of times a particular form is found in scripture, to full and effective spelling, and to abnormally written letters. The large Masorah is more copious in its notes. The final Masorah comprises all the longer rubrics for which space could not be found in the margin of the text, and is arranged alphabetically in the form of a concordance. The quantity of notes the marginal Masorah contains is conditioned by the amount of vacant space on each page. In the manuscripts it varies also with the rate at which the copyist was paid and the fanciful shape he gave to his gloss. There was accordingly an independent Babylonian Masorah which differed from the Palestinian in terminology and to some extent in order. The Masorah is concise in style with a profusion of abbreviations, requiring a considerable amount of knowledge for their full understanding. It was quite natural that a later generation of scribes would no longer understand the notes of the Masoretes and consider them unimportant. By the late medieval period they were reduced to mere ornamentation of the manuscripts. It was Jacob ben Chaim who restored clarity and order to them. In most manuscripts, there are some discrepancies between the text and the Masorah, suggesting that they were copied from different sources or that one of them has copying errors. The lack of such discrepancies in the Aleppo Codex is one of the reasons for its importance. The scribe who copied the notes, presumably Aaron ben Moses ben Asher, probably wrote them originally. Numerical Masorah in classical antiquity, copyists were paid for their work according to the number of sticks. As the prose books of the Bible were hardly ever written in sticks, the copyists, in order to estimate the amount of work, had to count the letters. For the Masoretic text, such statistical information more importantly also ensured accuracy in the transmission of the text with the production of subsequent copies that were done by hand. Hence the Masoretes contributed the numerical Masora. These notes are traditionally categorized into two main groups, the marginal Masora and the final Masora. The category of marginal Masora is further divided into the Masora Parva in the outer side margins and the Masora Magna, traditionally located at the top and bottom margins of the text. The Masora Parva is a set of statistics in the outer side margins of the text. Beyond simply counting the letters, the Masora Parva consists of word use statistics, similar documentation for expressions or certain phraseology, observations on full or defective writing, references to the Kethavkira readings and more. These observations are also the result of a passionate zeal to safeguard the accurate transmission of the sacred text. Even though often cited as very exact, the Masoretic frequency notes in the margin of Codex Leningradensis contained several errors. The Masora Magna, in measure, is an expanded Masora Parva. It is not printed in the Biblia Hebraica Stuttgartensia. The final Masora is located at the end of biblical books or after certain sections of the text, such as at the end of the Torah. It contains information and statistics regarding the number of words in a book or section, etc. Thus, Leviticus chapter 8 verse 23 is the middle verse in the Pentateuch. All the names of divinity mentioned in connection with Abraham are holy except Genesis chapter 18 verse 3. 10 passages in the Pentateuch are dotted. 3 times the Pentateuch has the spelling where the reading is. The collation of manuscripts and the noting of their differences furnished material for the text's critical Masora. The close relation which existed in earlier times between the teacher of tradition and the Masoreite, both frequently being united in one person, accounts for the exegetical Masora. Finally, the invention and introduction of a graphic system of vocalization and accentuation gave rise to the grammatical Masora. The most important of the Masoretic notes are those that detail the Kethavkira that are located in the Masora Parva in the outside margins of BHS. Given that the Masoretes would not alter the sacred consonantal text, the Kethavkira notes were a way of correcting or commenting on the text for any number of reasons deemed important by the copyist.